Hey there, Jill, how are you this morning?
Hey dude, I'm okay, how are you?
Oh, I'm great, it's really good to see you again, so
oh,
it is.
Oh good to see you too. Hey,
what have you been up to?
Well, hang on, we're on that thing again, aren't we?
Aye, we're live.
Hello, pals! Hello, I can see you. Oh, there you go. I can see Callum. Hey, Callum, good to see you. I can see lots of boys and girls. Give me a wave, pals. After three. One, two, three. Hiya, pals. Oh, you can shout louder than that. One, two, three. Hiya, pals. Oh, well, listen. What a week. Did you see us last week? What a disaster! Disaster! Firstly, something happened and people started to speak over us. It was like I was speaking over myself. Very weird. Then, did you hear the dude? Yes, you. You suddenly shouted, Sharon! Who is Sharon? That's who I want to know who she is. If you know, you can let me know, because I have no clue, but he shouted at the top of his voice, Sharon! And that's all you heard. And then, he cut off my singing. I had just started. Was that deliberate?
Nope.
I had just started singing, and suddenly, woof. So, anyway, I was in the huff for a good Wait.
What?
Where's Jack?
Well, I'm not sure if Jack will be here today.
Oh, what's up?
Because he's really, really upset and sad about what happened last week.
Oh, I was the same for about 5 minutes and then I got over it and I said to you, dude, it's okay, these things happen. Let's be honest, you are pretty rubbish at ICT.
Well.
And it's been a huge learning curve for you. So, well, I just got on with it and thought, well. Too bad. People will tune back if they want to see us. If they don't, then too bad. So, anyway, did you not get over it? Like, what's up with him?
I think you should maybe give him a shout just to see where he is. Oh. Well, I could try, but I mean, I think it maybe would be better coming for you, to be honest.
Oh, he's a big baby. Before we're shouting him anyway, this week, schools were doing lots of things and he was messing about, Jack was. He was supposed to be on his glow, and he wasn't on it. Oh, here he comes. Oops. Well, true, Jack, he didn't quite make the glow classroom. And even all the kids in Park Gordon, their school put out a box of resources to help them. So there's lots of things going on, and you were sorry, Jack. Oops.
Hello.
To come in case something would happen to me.
Well, I think something did happen this week again. Due to these ICT. Oops.
Well,
oops. Sorry,
what you're supposed to forgive, like the story in the Bible with Joseph.
With who?
Joseph.
Who's he?
Well, Joseph, he was a wee boy and he just looked after sheep and stuff like that. And then his brothers came and his brothers were going to sell him.
Sell him? Then? There's an idea! Evie, here I come! Jack for sale! No. £20! Woohoo!
Jill!
So, sorry.
That's not nice.
Sorry.
But some bad things happened to Joseph and he ended up in a pit.
A pit?
Yeah.
Oh no.
And some Egyptians came and well.
Oh, hold on! I know something. Boys and girls, shout out, you'll know this too. If you're an Egyptian, where do you come from? After three. 1, 2, 3. Egypt!
Well there we done. Go. Excellent.
I've been on my Excellent. Google Classrooms, that's why.
But actually, that the brothers of Joseph done a really bad thing.
Oh no.
But you know what? He managed to forgive them, and it helped him, and it helped his brothers as well.
Okay, so Jack, if it helped Joseph, and it helped his brothers, it'll help you too. Just forgive, dude, and then just get on with it. It doesn't matter.
Okay, dude. I forgive you.
Oh, well done, Jack.
Thank you. Mm.
Oh, dude, come a bit closer, dude. Come closer. Mm. There we go. All else ends well with forgiveness. That's a good thing to forgive people. Because otherwise...
Jill, what? Are you going to sing this week?
Well, there you go! Woo! But no, I've got something even better. There's a lady... There's a lady called Linda. And I think she might be watching. And if her big granddaughter called Olive's watching... Hi, Olive, she might be. She might watch it later. Hi, Olive, down in Edinburgh. Your granny is very, very clever. She's also granny to some other babies too, but I'm not going to mention them all because of GDPR. That's it. Don't want to give too much away about Linda, but she works in the coolest place in Bucky.
Where's that? The fish shop.
No, and it's not the ice cream shop either, and I can't tell you for GDPGG for that reason, but she is really clever, and she wrote a poem about the coronavirus called Corona.
A poem?
Yep, I tried to put it to a song, but the poem is better. Do you want to hear it? Jack!
Okay,
so here it goes, and then if you really think it's really good, because it really is, and that she should be famous, because I think she should be, because you know what? She writes poems like this all the time. So does her husband, Willie. He wrote poems...
Your voice is awful high. Are you going to manage to keep that voice going?
Be quiet. Okay. So, listen, Willie even said poems at his daughter's weddings for his speeches, and they were really funny. So they're a very talented couple. And if you want to know who she is, then tough luck. You need to ask me, and then I need to ask her. And if she wants to know you, then there you go. Anyway, here is the poem. Are you ready?
I've been ready for ages.
No need to be like that, Jack. Okay. Corona, Corona, it's coming here. At first I thought they were speaking about beer. The COVID-19 fits a taboot. Telling you on the TV, you canna go out. It's a flu bug from China that's gone to cause strife and certainly muck up the why we live life. We've to hole up in our houses and abide in, but we're allowed to the shoppy or to go out for a run. The schools are all shut. The bairns shout, yippee! Yee-haw! But it's nae a' fun playing because they've to dee school working a'. Can I go see your family to hae a cup of tea? Phone calls or FaceTime cottages and doorsteps is surely a sair sight. These hard times will pass. Maybe things nae quite the same, but for noo, just think, there's nae place like hame. Whoa, how cool is that point? Three cheers for Linda. Ready, everybody? Hip hip, hooray! Hip hip, hooray! Hip hip, hooray!
Hey, that was really good, Jill.
Thank you.
I'm going to go wee now.
Okay.
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 I'll see you later.
See you later then.
I'll see you next Sunday.
See you next Sunday, guys.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Well, good morning, folks. It's good to see you again here this morning. And who would believe that it's been 6 weeks since we went into lockdown? Time really does fly, so it does. And I hope it's not been too difficult for you. But I'm sure you've enjoyed Jack and Jill and the antics that these guys get up to. And now we come to a reading, which is taken from Luke chapter 5, verses 33-39. And I will be reading from the New International Version. And in the New International Version, the title of this passage is Jesus Questioned About Fasting. We're going to start a new series, and the title of the series is What Did Jesus Say About? What did Jesus say about? And we'll be taking this from the different parables that we find in Scripture. And of course, a parable is a story that Jesus told to illustrate a point. A story that Jesus told to illustrate a point. The first one that we're going to really consider is what's called the old and the new wineskins. So as I say, Luke chapter 5, reading from verse 33. They said to him, John's disciples often fast and pray, and so the disciples of the Pharisee, but yours go on eating and drinking. Jesus answered, can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. In those days they will fast. He goes on to say, he told them this parable. No one tears a piece out of a new garment to patch the old one. If he does, he will have torn the new garment, and the patch from the old one will not match the old. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins. If he does this, the new wine will burst the skin. The wine will run out, and the wine skins will be ruined. No new wine must be poured into new wineskins. And no one after drinking old wine wants the new, for he says the old is better. And thanks be to God for the reading of his word. Within this parable, we see the contrast between the old and the new, and how they really don't fit together. There are three similar contrasts in this first. First of all, how can you make guests fast at a wedding? Just doesn't seem logical, that at all. When you put an old patch on a new cloth, then you will see the difference. And again, I'm sure we have noticed or witnessed that. And then lastly, if you try to patch up a new wineskin, then they would have been used to store wine. Then again, it really wouldn't work. As it says in that passage, If we tried to store or put new wine into an old wine, then it would burst. This morning, I really want to look at this from two different perspectives. First of all, from the church, from the church's perspective, and then briefly look at it from a society's viewpoint as well. I don't know if you're like me, but I'm hearing over and over again that the circumstances that we find ourselves in the moment, and at the moment, is the new normal. I think really the question needs to be asked, what does this mean for the church? And of course, when I'm speaking about the church, I'm not speaking about a building, but I'm speaking about a body of believers, or some may call Christians or followers of Christ. Rightly or wrongly, we have been thrown into a new way of working as a church, which personally I feel blessed by, but also really challenged. Challenged about how can we do this different? Is this right? Is this wrong? Should we be doing this, or could we do it this way? It's interesting that the parable says that the old doesn't work with the new. And we see that similarities through that whole reading. So we do. That really the old stuff doesn't work with the new stuff. I would suggest that we, as a church, run the risk of trying to work the same method, but in a new environment. Taking the new way of doing things and moulding that into the old environment from which we came. John Cursons says in his application commentary, and this is quite a lengthy reading, but it's an absolutely powerful reading in terms of what we're looking at this morning. So let me just quote John Cursons. When people try to put something of a new moving of the Lord into an old structure, they end up not only quenching the wine of the Spirit, but blowing apart the structure in the process. This applies to people individually as well as the churches corporately. For here is what happens. When people are touched by the Lord and filled by the Spirit, the new wine of joy and vitality begins to bubble within them. But they will often discover that, as happened with Jesus following his own baptism, they will be driven into the wilderness, into battle, possibly even into hard times. And it is at this point that, unwillingly to face the difficulty or challenge, the temptation or trial, they burst, give up, and go back to the predictability of their previous ways, where they can go to church occasionally, put in the odd pound or two in the offering, and play the game, as it were. Does this mean we are doomed to become hardened old wineskins that cannot contain the new work of the Lord at any given time? I don't think so. You see, the Greek word translated new in relation to wine is neos, but the word translated new in relation to wineskins is kainos, and literally means to be renewed. In Bible days, wineskins were relatively expensive, so when they began to get hard, he who didn't have money for a new one would soak the old one in water until the elasticity and flexibility returned. I find the analogy interesting because the scriptures are likened unto water. And we can find reference to this from John 15, verse 3, and Ephesians 5 and 26. How do we stay flexible, usable, and contemporary in whatever the Lord might be doing, both corporately and personally? We soak ourselves not in traditionalism or denominationalism, but in the Word. If we make the Word the priority of our life, the emphasis of our ministry, it will have a softening, renewing effect on us. But when the Bible is no longer predominance or priority in the life of a church or an individual, and instead replaced by programs, traditions, or denominational expectations, rigidity is sure to follow. The entire Bible can be read aloud in 71 hours or 12 minutes a day for a year. Most of us spend more time than that simply brushing our teeth or combing our hair. The question is not whether we have time to read the Word. The question is, do we choose to do it? There is only one place a believer cannot stay. He cannot stay put. That is, he is either growing and expanding in his walk, or he is shrinking and weakening in his walk. Your faith is either more radical today than it was last year, or it is less so. If we are determined together to soak in the Word, we will experience and continuing renewing, new discoveries, new understanding, constant softening, and the Lord will be able to pour new wine into our vessels. It's interesting to see different churches finding out different ways of doing church online. This isn't a new thing. There has been some doing this for a while, but for the majority of us, it is new. And we ask the question, is there any right way of doing it? Is there a wrong way of doing it? No, it is just the way that we do it. I think about this parable in these terms, it may help us understand it better. Just to use another analogy, an analogy about a car. If we take a Mark 1 Ford Escort, for instance, or a Model T Ford, and compare that to a newer model like a Ford Focus or something similar, I'm sure you would agree that in comparison, there are a lot more advantages to having a newer model. There may be still some who prefer the old style of car, but the majority of people, I would say, would choose the latest model, especially if it's going for free. Both models have wheels, both has transmission, both has a steering wheel, brake lights, headlights, and the two different models have seats as well. But the newer model has made the older one obsolete. I wonder, has the new model of church making the older model obsolete? Or can the two work side by side? Can we have the newer model of church working alongside the older model of church as well? I think the danger is that we fall back into the older model, which doesn't always work the same way as the newer might do. So in regards to society, we've looked at the church, now we'll look at society and what is the new way of working. I think we need to ask what we have learned during this time, or what are we learning during this new way of doing things? I would suggest there are a good few things that we have learned in the midst of this terrible pandemic. Human contact is one. We see that so many say that they feel the importance of human contact. The new way of doing things is okay, and it works. But when we can actually sit down with someone, then we see the advantages of this. And yet, the new way of doing things may have opened new opportunities, new avenues to communicate with those who we hold dear, but are not staying within the same vicinity as we. Some of these folks may be staying further afield, and I'm sure there are many in this same position. I also think it's a time where people has refocused their attention and refocused their attention on those who are isolated, whether the elderly, infirm, or those who are not able to get out and about the same. When thinking about this, my mind went back to the beginning of the Bible. In fact, the beginning of time, where God created man and he saw that it was good to create man. But in actual fact, he realized that it would be better if he had company. It would be better if he had a partner. So he created woman from a man's side, the rib of a man. Even way back then, we see that it was good to have company. But we can do this in new ways. It may be difficult for us to go and actually visit someone else's home. But a 10-minute FaceTime, a 10-minute Skype call would help tremendously for that person who is isolated. And I'm sure we all can manage that. Even a cheery phone call if people don't have access to the internet. And then what about our NHS and key workers? Again, I think there has been a reinvigoration of the NHS service. If we think about what it used to be like when it was first started, when it was first established, I'm sure we would never dream of going back to the methods that they used, to the way that they did things when it was first started. The modern equipment is amazing, as are the staff who operate and serve in this way. Still amazes me when thinking about Colonel Tom Moore and what one man can actually achieve. It really is staggering. And not just a man who is elderly, 99, 100 years old, and when we think of his an amazing achievement, raising all that money for the NHS. Hopefully, this has made us reconsider the many health services that we do have, and maybe appreciate them more and do what we can to help in any way. It may well have made the government assess their contribution and how they work with the NHS as well. It may mean new wine rather than sticking to old systems. And then we have freedom. I don't know about you, but people have felt restricted. People have felt that they've not got the same freedom as they used to have. They can't go for a drink, or they can't go for a meal, or nip to the Chinese restaurant and get a meal from there. They just feel as if they're being restricted. One thing that's still in my mind, and reading about it and hearing about it in the media, is a gentleman who was being interviewed, and the person that was interviewing him said, "What does isolation mean for you?" And it was his response that really has stuck by me. And his response was this. He said, "My mind is free, so I can be anywhere I like. My mind is free, so I can be anywhere I like." Powerful, powerful statement if we think about that. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7 it says this, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind." The old wineskins for you may well be depression. It may be fear. It may be a troubled mind. And during this time it has been especially difficult. Can I urge you, why not try to let the Spirit flow over you? Allow yourself to start the healing. Allow yourself to experience the freedom of mind that the Spirit can give. In fact, why don't we just take a minute or two just to pray over you at this point? So let's pray. Father, we just come before you at this time, and Lord, we do realise that there may be some listening to this morning who have got that spirit of fear. Lord, we just ask that you would bind up that fear and cast it aside. Father, we pray that we don't have a spirit of fear. Lord, we just pray that your spirit would take that fear and disperse it. Father, that you would just cast it out. Or Father, it may be that we're living under a cloud of depression. Lord, we just pray that that cloud would be lifted. Father, that your light again may shine into those who suffer from this. Father, that they may have clarity of mind. Father, it may be someone whose mind's troubled at this time, who's confused. And Lord, again, we ask that you would bring peace of mind for them. Lord, just still the waters of their mind, we ask. Lord, come in a new way, come in a fresh way. Come in a new, renewing way, we ask. Lord, we just pray that you would flood them with your Spirit. And again, we just ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Maybe that prayer has spoken to you, and again, can I urge you just to contact me, whether through the phone or through Facebook or something like that. But don't hesitate to contact so that we can have a chat. But maybe you've had to reevaluate during this time and think, what actually is important to me? What is it that I hold dear? Is it my work? Is it my finances? Is it my leisure time? Or actually, is it my family? Financially, you may have hit a difficult part and you've had to reevaluate during this time and think, actually, what is it that's important? You may be feel as if things are collapsing all around you, and all of a sudden you think to yourself, I've worked really hard to get all these things and now there is a real threat that it's going to be taken away. And yet, remember this, you still have your family and you still have your health. Two things that is really important. Two things that may be important, more important than your financial situation. Again, it's a time to set up new goals, to set up new wineskins. I've quoted this verse a lot over the years, and I still believe it is applicable and true today. Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says this, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." You may be thinking, where does my future lie? And how can I see the light at the end of a tunnel? It may well be a time to start looking at something differently than you've been involved in before. It may be a time when you ditch the old and start something new. If I can urge you, why don't you try a life with Jesus? Try involving Him in every decision that you make. I need to be honest and say it will not be easy, especially if everything you have worked for is falling apart. That is one thing that is difficult. But this I can guarantee, that you will have a fulfilled life. You will have someone to support you, and you will be able to rebuild and be successful in your new life with Christ. Why don't you take this time just to look into these things? So let's close this point just with a word of prayer. Father, again, we thank you for this time that we've just looked into this parable. And Lord, we pray that it may have spoken to someone listening to this morning. And Lord, we thank you for the blessing that you bestow upon us. And again, we just ask these things in your precious name. Amen. Now, we're going to go into a time of worship with Kari, Jobe and Cody, Carnes. And again, we thank these guys for making this resource available. So let's just worship before God with Kari, Jobe and Cody, Carnes.
Hey you guys, it's Carrie and Cody, and we're just so honored to get to worship with you today. And you know, I know it looks different right now. Church looks different, and worshiping together looks different. But I love the fact that we serve a God that has not changed. His presence hasn't changed. His spirit hasn't changed. Truths from the Word of God have not changed. And so we're just leaning in together with you to just call on heaven, to just worship with you right there wherever you are. And I know some of you are with your families, but I know some of you are not. And some of you have been isolated for a few weeks, and you've been alone and haven't even been able to be with friends. And we just really feel a lot of support and just intentionality to just minister over your lives today. And I wanted to read this. It's Psalm 121. It's one of my favorite psalms. And it just says, "I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, who does not let your foot slip. He who watches over you does not sleep. He watches over you, he does not sleep." I love that. It repeats itself. I think it's important that we just be reminded when we're asleep, when you're alone and you're asleep, he's watching over you. It says it again, "The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun cannot harm you. The moon cannot harm you. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life." We just declare that over every one of you watching today. Let's just worship the Lord together and just call on heaven. Lord, I just thank you for your presence. And it's real and it's tangible. that wherever we find ourselves right now in this moment, you are with us. You are God. You're not shaken. You watch over us. Thank you that your truths from the Word are true and real and right. We can hold on to them. We just speak life over our friends today. Lord, let your presence just come and fill every home and every place, every car, every situation, hospitals. Maybe you're in the car and you're a doctor or a nurse, you're about to go into work. Wherever you are right in this very moment, God is with you. And he watches over your life. Thank you, Lord.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding, the reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, oh, I can't comprehend. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Long know I need you. I know I need you. Thank you that you're always there. There's nothing that we face, you're not with us. You're here now, walking hand in hand with us. So we lift our eyes to where our help comes from. We lift our eyes to where our help comes from. I know my help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hard reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Call me as your own. You amaze me, you're with me, you call me as your own.
astray. You're my defender. You're my refuge in the storm. Through these trials, you've always been faithful. You bring healing to my soul. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will never leave me. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will never, you never leave. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will. Because you said it is. Oh, there's a peace that passes all understanding. Because he said it will. That's all you have to know, it's because he said it. There's a peace that passes all understanding. Because he said it, because he said it will. Because he said. You said it, and if you said it, then I will trust it. Because you said it, because you said it, then I will trust you. It is so sweet. His favor be upon you and the thought. generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and 1,000 generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and 1,000 generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and 1,000 generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around. Every voice today, let's just sing amen again.